Paul Revere Williams was born February 18th, 1894 at his parents' house at 842 Santee Street downtown.
The English are coming. Okay, that's all I'm going to get out of here.
The English are building? His parents were Chester and Lila Williams, and they came to LA from Memphis in 1893 with Paul's older brother, Chester Jr., and they opened up a fruit stand at Olvera Street. They were a happy family once Paul was born, and then when he was 2, his dad died of tuberculosis.
Sucks.
Then when he was 4, his mom died of tuberculosis. And Paul was separated from his brother and put into a foster home at 784 East 15th Street to live with a lady named Emily P. Clarkson.
And then the orphanage died of tuberculosis.
It's not an orphanage, it's a foster home.
And it died
of tuberculosis. As a kid, he'd wander around the city picking up tuberculosis. He'd just walk around and he learned Chinese and German from people he met who lived in his neighborhood.
That's pretty cool.
And he always had a notebook where he would draw the buildings that he saw around town. He went to Sentius Avenue Grammar School on Pico Boulevard starting in 1900, where he was the only African-American student. Keep in mind that at this time there were only 3,131 African-Americans in LA. He then went to Polytechnic High School, where he expressed aspirations to become an architect to his guidance counselor, who apparently stared at me with as much astonishment as he would have had I proposed a rocket flight to Mars, which will happen.
Get him there.
So the guidance counselor told him, "Whoever heard of a Negro being an architect? Your own people can't afford you, and white clients won't hire you. Have a nice day."
What do you really want to do?
But hey, graduation's right around the corner, so you should work hard at that.
You could do anything but what you want to do. On record, asshole.
This was a turning point in his life where he decided that if I allow the fact that I am Negro to checkmate my will to do now, I will inevitably form the habit of being defeated. He'd only ever heard of one black architect, so he thought that the world could use one or two more. In June 1912, he graduated Polytechnic High School, and it was time to build his dream.
I don't get it.
Dad joke. He was mostly studying on his own and joined the Los Angeles Architectural Club and took some night classes at the Los Angeles School of Art and training from the Society of Beaux-Arts Architects starting in 1913. But he wasn't a kid anymore drawing pictures of the Bradbury building in his notebook. He needed money, so he looked through the phone book. I'm just a kid walking around town with a dream and tuberculosis affecting everybody. He needed money, so he looked through the phone book and made a list of all the architecture companies in town and started going door to door to see who was hiring. He was offered a position working for Wilbur D. Cook Jr., who had done the gardens of the Beverly Hills Hotel. Mm-hmm. And even though it was an unpaid position, he took it in 1913 because that was a pretty big deal.
Yeah.
They started paying him after a little bit, but in 1914, he moved on to the Pasadena-based Reginald David Johnson, where he was put on the job of designing a luxury home, which was the first time he had exposure to that sort of thing.
Yeah.
That same year, he won first prize in a national student competition for his design of a civic center in Pasadena. In 1915, he was officially certified as a building contractor so that he could legally make small things.
Mm-hmm.
In 1916, he decided that he wanted to learn the practical stuff that would go into actually creating the things he was designing. So he entered the architectural engineering program at USC, which had only 8 students at the time. In 1917, he started working for Arthur Kelly, who specialized in hotels, residences, and public buildings, and had designed the horniest place on earth, the Playboy Mansion.
Horny.
Horny was in the air that year, as on June 27, Williams married Della Mae Givens, who would go on to found the Wyffendale Club, which is the oldest social and philanthropic club in LA.
Oh, wow.
African American, that is. I think. What are we talking about? Together, they would have a son who died as an infant. Tuberculosis.
Really?
No, I don't know. He died, though. And that's funny. They also had 2 daughters, Marilyn and Norma. He graduated from USC in 1919 and continued apprenticing for Kelly. In 1920, he was appointed to the LA City Planning Commission, on which he served until 1928. 1921, he moves on to the John C. Austin firm, who specialized in large public and commercial projects such as the Shrine Auditorium and the Hollywood Masonic Temple, Jimmy Kimmel Studio. Jimmy Kimmel's. Which were worked on during his time there, even though he was just a draftsman. But the big thing to happen that year was that he was licensed as an architect by the state of California, making him the first African-American architect west of the Mississippi.
Awesome.
Which, again, all of Los Angeles was west of the Mississippi. No. 1922 was another big step forward as he became a member of the Southern California chapter of the American Institute of Architects, but 1923 was really the big year. He moved above just the Southern California chapter and became the first African-American member of the American Institute of Architects, which is a pretty big deal. Yeah. That same year, he also opened up his own firm, Paul R. Williams and Associates, in the Stock Exchange building downtown. He was 28 years old and had been living at 784 East 15th Street with his wife and foster mom, but around this time, he moved to 1271 West 35th in South Central. This was a good time to open up an architecture business because in the 20s, LA was going through a big boom, real estate boom.
Baby go boom.
Baby go big boom. He started out with small jobs because he wasn't offered much in the early days, but he didn't mind that because he had always wanted to design affordable homes for low-income families. Like, that's what he was... But then he was offered a big project from one of the founders of AAA, Lewis Cast, to design his new home in the new ritzy, and still ritzy as ever, Flint Ridge. The house was a hit, and he ended up designing 10 homes there, making it one of the largest concentrations of his work in town.
That's pretty cool.
From this, he started getting offered bigger projects, like a big public complex in Monrovia in 1924. In 1926, he did a two-story school at 1314 South Dakota, not spelled like you think it is, street in Boyle Heights, mm-hmm. next to Lou Costello Jr. Park, which I don't know why that's there. Abbott Swimming Pool is right next to it, hitting it over the head.
Spilling water into it.
After being told that the black community would not provide any work for him, he proved racism wrong yet again, as in 1924, he redid the Second Baptist Church on Central Avenue, which was the first African-American church in LA. He also did the 28th Street YMCA on Central Avenue, which was the first YMCA in LA for black men. And on the facade of it, he put images of Booker T. Washington and Frederick Douglass. That building's on the National Register of Historic Places. Later on, in 1963, he even redid the first African Methodist Episcopal Church in West Adams, which was originally co-founded by Biddy Mason.
Oh, cool.
This was also the church where Williams had gotten married. Outside of the black community, he had a hand in a lot of stuff all over the city. He did the Marina Del Rey High School, the LA County Courthouse, the Westwood Medical Center, Hillside Memorial Park, the Esso Gas Station at LAX, the Fedco Department Store in Pasadena, the Sunset Plaza Apartments, the Pueblo Del Rio Housing Project, which became a model for public housing nationwide, Angela's Funeral Home, the Golden State Mutual Life Insurance Building, the Music Corporation of America headquarters, for which he got an award of merit from the SoCal AIA. Mm-hmm. He remodeled the Hollywood YMCA. You might remember he also did part of the Nazi compound Murphy Ranch, which brings us to World War II. During this time, a lot of architecture firms closed down, including Williams, as he devoted his time to helping out the Navy working on a fort in Arizona and the Roosevelt Naval Base and a naval station in Long Beach.
They needed all the architecture plans for bullets.
They melted them down. After the war, he was a big proponent of affordable housing for veterans, but some of his most iconic things came after the war as well. He worked on the remodel of the Beverly Hills Hotel in the late 40s, doing the tropical lobby, the bungalows, the polo lounge, the fountain coffee shop,
really?
And even the signage on the front. He did the coffee shop in the Ambassador Hotel, as you might remember. Bang, bang. Bad things happen. He did the interior
of... He's a second shooter.
It was one of those architecture bullets from the war. He did the interior of Saks Fifth Avenue in Beverly Hills. Jeez. He redesigned the Knickerbocker Hotel. He did the Respiratory Center at Rancho Los Amigos.
Really?
And the Communicable Diseases Building at the LA County General Hospital, making that the first major public building in the city to have been designed by an African American.
Get it.
He was also one of the designers of the theme building at LAX. But he wasn't just your everyday public building barrier breaking architect. There's a reason why Polly Williams was known as the architect to the stars, because he was, in fact, our Lord and Savior, Xenu. He created all that there is. He created all that there was. This is Scientology. You've all been listening to a Scientology podcast by
Make the Checks Out to Scientology.
Make it out to L. Ron Mee. He designed the homes of many names that might be more familiar to you than the Fedco Department Store. He made homes for people you might have heard of, like Frankie Sinatra, Barbara Stanwyck, the sinfully cohabitating Humphrey Bogart and Lauren Bacall, Anthony Quinn, Zsa Zsa Gabor, Tyrone Power, Bill Bojangles Robinson, founder of CBS, William Paley, Otto Preminger, Lon Chaney, wow. Cary Grant.
The coffee version of Cary Grant.
Dark Roast. Eddie Rochester Anderson. The Cowardly Lion, Burt Lahr. The Cowardly Cuban, Desi Arnaz. His cowering wife, Lucille Ball. And his close friend, Danny Thomas. Okay. And when that close friend, Danny Thomas, was trying to start a little endeavor of his in Memphis, Paul Williams stepped in and created a design for his St. Jude Research Hospital for Children completely free of charge.
Wow, really?
Yeah. Williams was even the advisor on the 1948 RKO movie movie Mr. Blanding Builds His Dream House, starring Cary Grant, Cary Coffee Grounds.
Cary Coffee Grounds Grant.
And the Clampett Mansion on the Beverly Hillbillies was a Williams house.
No way.
Yeah. That's a fact.
That's the Green Acres, by the way. You're Beverly right. Hillbillies is, here's a little story about a man named Jed. How many 70s TV show theme songs can we...
Celebrities were drawn to his style for his designs that had lots of open space, long curving staircases, and what they described as a casual elegance. A lot like me. A long curving staircase.
Like a femme fatale.
He mixed Mediterranean, Spanish Revival, and English Tudor styles into something that was its own sort of thing. He was also the pioneer of things like hidden retractable screens and having the patio as part of the house. He was also big on steel homes. I steal homes.
I'm a squatter.
He was making these homes in ritzy parts of the city like Hancock Park and Windsor Square, but it wasn't just in LA that he was making stuff. He designed a few buildings in Las Vegas and Reno. He became licensed to work in Nevada, New York, Tennessee, and Washington, D.C., where he co-designed Langston Terrace in 1936, which was the first federally funded public housing project.
Damn.
But America just wasn't enough for him. He went global, baby.
No.
Yeah.
No.
Yeah, he did the United Nations building in Paris, a hotel in Colombia, and I'm just making the connection now to his past, a tuberculosis hospital in Ecuador.
He cried the entire time.
It's in the shape of his mother.
No!
That made me sad. The accolades kept parading in. In 1933, he was appointed to the first ever Los Angeles Housing Commission, on which he served until 1941. That same year, he started serving on the National Board of Municipal Housing and ended up working on commissions under Presidents Coolidge, Roosevelt, and Eisenhower. He was the president of the LA Municipal Art Commission for 11 years. He wrote two books, The Small Home of Tomorrow in 1945 and New Homes for Today in 1946.
The sequel?
He gave advice to architects like, know when to quit, because people don't always know what they want. It's the architect's job to help them find it and keep within the bounds of grace. He got USC's Distinguished Alumni Award. He got honorary doctorates from Howard University, Lincoln University, which I think are two of the names from Stephen Fetchett's real name, and the Tuskegee Institute. In 1950, he became the AIA's first African American fellow. This time it is a man fellow.
Man fellow.
Who's that man fellow you brought home?
Is he man or fellow?
Both. In 1962, Ebony Magazine listed him as one of the 100 richest African Americans, and in 1964, Time Magazine named him as one of the most successful African Americans. I'd rather be the rich one. But don't forget that he was African American in the early and mid part of the 20th century, and he had to navigate through that. The greatest irony of his life was that many of the houses he designed, he would not have been able to live in because those neighborhoods did not allow black people. His very first luxury home in Flint Ridge was in a very rich, very white area where black people weren't even allowed to spend the night.
Oh my God, they had that. What was it?
Sundown laws?
Yeah, something sundown like laws, that. Yeah.
Just Flint Ridge rule.
Glendale and Burbank had them.
Yeah, but they're closer than Flint Ridge. Many clients would come to his office not knowing that he was black, and when they walked in the room, like, oh,
This isn't where I parked my car.
They would lock up and try to find an excuse to leave as quick as they could. But he believed that people would be tolerant of him once he showed them what he was capable of. Sometimes he was right about that. Sometimes he was wrong about that. Yeah. He didn't want to make his white clients uncomfortable having to sit next to him while he drew up plans. So he taught himself how to draw upside down so that they could sit comfortably across the table from him and not have to sit next, God forbid, sit next to a black man. He'd also walk around construction sites with his hands behind his back. So it would be up to the white clients to initiate a handshake if they wanted to and not be put. If he stuck his hand out, it would be awkward if they're like, I don't want to shake your hand.
Such a talented, prolific guy, had to still accommodate people.
Yeah, but he had some strange feelings about how it was fine that African Americans were segregated, and he supported Nixon in 1960, which is weird. But he was still very much active in bettering the Los Angeles African American community. He gave to charities and stuff like that. He also designed and served as vice president and director of the Broadway Federal Savings and Loan, who would give out loans to black GIs after World War II when other places wouldn't. This was the oldest African-American savings and loan west of the Mississippi, yet again, before it was destroyed in the 92 riots, along with
the Mississippi River was destroyed in the riots?
Destroyed now. They kicked it too much. You didn't know that, Greg? You're dumb.
You got no smarts in your head.
It's the Mississippi dirt road now. Yeah. So along with the building being destroyed, tons of his sketches and plans that were inside were like burned. In the July 1937 issue of the American Magazine, he wrote an essay called I Am a Negro, detailing the things he had to go through. And in 1953, he won the Spingarn Medal from the NAACP for urging African Americans to become active citizens by becoming homeowners. That same year, for some some reason, he and his wife were responsible for tricking the first black contestant onto the set of This Is Your Life. Because they would have, like, someone would be like, oh, we're going to get ice cream. And then they show up on the set.
And then you throw a bag over their head. And you take them to CBS.
You pour water on them and say, this is your life. This is your life. You don't want to lose it, do you? Give me the plan.
Sidebar. Terrifying idea for a show. To sit there and, like, this kid that used to stab you in kindergarten.
He's now sleeping with your wife. This is your life. He retired from architecturing in 1973 and devoted his life to his family. He was a really devoted dad and husband, and he always considered architecture his hobby.
Oh, wow.
He never brought work home. Home, by the way, was in Lafayette Square near Crenshaw and Venice Boulevard. Mm-hmm. That house is now an LA historic and cultural landmark. But when he was home, he was home. He didn't talk about that. He wasn't talking about the celebrities he met. Nothing about that. He just gave love and attention to his family.
What's that like?
I'm sorry, Greg. I'm sorry. When I come home, I just want to talk about all the celebrities I met that day. I met William Hung, Greg. I met William Hung. You could see them all pretty often at Philippe's. They'd be going there. Yeah, William Hung. He just loved it. He dips. They would be at Philippe's often, which may or may not have led to the diabetes that killed him on January 23rd, 1980.
Why did you do that?
At age 85.
You didn't prepare me.
Well, come on. Sometimes you just crash into a pier. Life happens. His funeral was also at the first AME church. His heart crashed into a pier of cholesterol. In his obituary, they said he not only designed buildings, Paul R. Williams designed lives. Paul R. Williams designed the future and dreams of tomorrow. He's buried at Inglewood Park Cemetery, and he was a level 33 Freemason. So I want to know his secrets.
Lizard people.
He was buried in the ground and then taken on the other end by the lizard people where he was resuscitated. There's alternate facts. There's a memorial to him at the Golden State Mutual building that they put up in 2015. When all was said and done, he had designed some 2,500 buildings, around 2,000 of those in LA, and he did this in a time when LA was just coming into its own and trying to figure out its style, and Williams put forth a look that started to get copied and imitated by other architects, and that got spread around the city, so a lot of the look of LA is rooted in Paul Williams' designs. He's been referred to as the Jackie Robinson of architecture. You know he went to UCLA?
No.
In December 2016...
You know, Tom Bradley went there.
Who?
He was a librarian. No.
He was a librarian. He was the first barber to be a gumshoe librarian. surfer. In December 2016, he was awarded the American Institute of Architects Gold Medal, which is the country's highest honor for an architect, and was the first African-American ever to receive that, even though he was dead. He didn't quite blaze as big a trail for African-Americans in the world of architecture as he might have hoped, as only 5% of the AIA is currently African-American. Mm-hmm. But his impact on the city is clear. His stuff went out of style in the 50s when modernism came in, so a lot of stuff got demolished, but the homes he did that still exist are revered. Paul revered Williams. I get it now. And they are hard to come by because people that live in them don't want to leave them because they're so nice. And when they do go up for sale, they're gone like immediately. If you want to know more about him, there's the Paul R. Williams Project that started in 2006 to spread the knowledge of his story. And the AIA even has a map of all the major buildings made by black architects in LA. And if they weren't made by Williams himself, they were inspired by Williams.
Wow, that's fantastic.
Yeah. That's the city.
Yay.